Hello everyone. My name is Sridhar, and with me I have my colleague Aswin. We both work for Red Hat. So today we'll be talking about hybrid cloud and multi-cluster service discovery. So agenda for today is as follows. We will briefly be going over the Kubernetes networking model, the use cases that motivated us, the problem domain, technologies that we looked into, and finally the solution that we actually came across and we found that it is very promising and we intend to contribute to. Some brief introduction about the Kubernetes networking model is, like, in Kubernetes every pod has a unique IP address and it can talk to other pods and services within the local cluster regardless of the node on which the pod is scheduled on. Not only that, a pod IP is generally isolated to the outside world, and there are well-defined mechanisms like load balancer services, ingress gateways, using which you can make your applications accessible to outside world. So as you can see, Kubernetes mainly focuses on container networking within the local cluster, but it does not talk about cross-cluster network connectivity. Imagine multiple clusters. Some of your clusters are on-prem and some on public clouds. And this is becoming a common deployment scenario these days. In a hybrid cloud kind of environment, some of the use cases that we kind of envision include high availability. Like, you have an application and you want your application to be deployed in multiple clusters in a hybrid cloud, and in the unfortunate situation, if one of your cluster goes down, you still have access to your application from a different cluster in a remote region. The other use case we can think of is like deploying a service mesh kind of application into your hybrid cloud, and some implementations of service mesh require pod-to-pod reachability. The next one we can think of is like stretched databases. And the next one, interesting one, is like enabling access to your cluster IP services from remote clusters. Normally, as you know, Kubernetes has different types of services, cluster IP being the default. And cluster IP service is generally accessible only within your local cluster. So we are looking at some solution wherein you can access the cluster IP service even from a remote cluster. So that is something that we are kind of interested in. The next use case is like you have a database on your prem and your application or your front end on the edge closer to your customers. The next use case we can think of is like deploying some temporary applications on public clouds to make use of the special hardware that is only available on the public clouds and not on your on-prem environment. And this goes on. Like, you know, this is not an exhaustive list of all the use cases, but these are some of the use cases that we had in our mind when we kind of looked at the hybrid cloud kind of use cases. Now, before we talk about the problem domain, some of the goals that we had in our mind is to find a solution that is cloud agnostic, lightweight, and also CNI agnostic. We just discussed about some of the use cases earlier, and some of them require pod-to-pod reachability even across the clusters. Like, you have a cluster in on-prem and you have an application or a pod in your on-prem and you want this pod to be able to talk to a pod in public cloud like AWS or GCP or whatnot. So we envision that this particular problem consists of four main aspects. One is tunnel management, injecting routing rules, multi-cluster network policy, and multi-cluster service discovery. Now, this is a pictorial representation of the problem domain that we just spoke about. We envision that we would require some kind of orchestrator that is capable of configuring, monitoring, and upgrading the cross-cluster connections. Further to that, the four main problem domains that I just spoke about can be categorized into two different categories. One is the cluster connectivity, and the other one is service connectivity. So let's go back to the four important things, and you know, let me give you a brief introduction of as to what we think of each of these aspects. One is the tunnel management. It essentially means like when you have your clusters in multiple regions, it's like setting up connections between your clusters so that the traffic can actually pass on from one cluster to other cluster. Now, tunnel management at the same time could be like what type of tunnel that you intend to use could depend on the location of your clusters. So if you're talking about connecting clusters from on-prem to a public cloud, you might want to go with standard space via IPsec tunnel. Pretty much most of the public cloud service providers support IPC based VPN tunnels. On the other hand, if you are talking about connecting clusters that are in your on-prem environment, then you can simply go with some kind of overlay mechanisms like VXLAN tunnels or an IP kind of tunnels, because the traffic is not going into your public domain and you want to avoid the overhead of encryption. Injecting routing rules, on the other hand, is about programming the necessary routing rules into your cluster nodes so that the pods, when they're trying to talk to the pods on the remote cluster or the cluster IP service on the remote cluster, there are necessary IP routing rules programmed so that the traffic is appropriately routed into your cluster. Service connectivity is like consists of multi-cluster service discovery. You all know about service discovery. So what we're looking at is we want to make a cluster IP service that is available in one of a cluster accessible from a connected cluster in a remote region. Now, when I talk about multi-cluster service discovery, we're not talking about exposing each and every service that is created in your cluster to a remote cluster, but we are looking at exposing services that are marked with some specific annotation so that only the annotated services are made available in the remote regions. And the fourth important thing is about multi-cluster network policy. So as you all know, network policy is like an access control list using which you can specify the kind of traffic that you want to allow or deny to your pods. We want to kind of enhance this to make it work with even a hybrid cloud kind of environment. With the goals that we had in our mind, we started to explore the various solutions which will allow us to, you know, address these four problem domains we had. We kind of prototyped some of them and to evaluate the technical feasibility of them and, you know, tried it out on vanilla Kubernetes as well as OpenShift and so on. Now, while we were doing this, some of our team members in parallel, they were trying to explore some of the upstream external open source projects. And we came across a couple of them, like Cilium, Federation, Istio, and so on. We found that Cilium is a very promising CNI. It's a full-fledged CNI, which was having lots of capabilities, and it was addressing most of the use cases that we kind of spoke about. However, since one of the goals that we had in our mind was to have a lightweight as well as a CNI agnostic solution, we had to park it. The second solution that you know we looked at was Federation. Federation is a control plane protocol that helps you to federate your services across multiple clusters. Federation currently does not set up any tunnels between your clusters, but it makes use of publicly accessible load balancer based services when it wants to make one of the service accessible from a different region. Istio, on the other hand, is a service mesh implementation, you all know that, and it has some fancy, like very good layer 7 capabilities. However, not every customer might be interested in deploying a service mesh kind of application for cross cluster connectivity. So somewhere in the month of April, while we were evaluating all these POCs, we came across an upstream open source project called Submariner from Rancher Labs. They also gave a demo at that time. So we found that Submariner was very much close to some of the problem domains that we were talking about, and it also had some pretty similar goals that we had. Not only that, actually, the general idea that we had in mind was also very close to what Submariner was trying to implement and address. So we felt that it would be a good step for us to start working with the Submariner community and add any necessary, you know, missing elements to it. So now Ashwin will talk about Submariner, its architecture, and some of the internals of Submariner project.
Thanks, Sridhar.
With that said, like, let us dive a little deep into the Submariner and its architecture and its components. So this is how a typical Submariner deployment looks like. So in the you can see a east cluster and a west cluster, and a third cluster that is called as the broker cluster. Okay. So the broker cluster now needs to be a third Kubernetes cluster, but our plan is to make it to install it in one of the east or west clusters, existing clusters. Now we install Submariner using Helm. So while you're deploying, you have to install it in your broker cluster first. After that, you need to get the secrets and the certificates, and you have to use that to deploy the west and east cluster so it can connect to the broker cluster. Submariner defines two CRDs, namely the cluster.submariner.io and the endpoints.submariner.io. So the cluster.submariner.io CRD contains the cluster information, the service CIDR, and the pod CIDR that are available in that cluster. Whereas the endpoint.submariner.io cluster contains the details about the cluster, like the node IP, the gateway node IP. I'll tell what that in detail later. And other details, like whether there is an address required to reach the gateway node. Those informations are stored in the endpoint.submariner.io. So here we require the cluster ID to be unique, so that each cluster should be identifiable by a unique ID. If you had attended the early session, like Shishidhara was telling, like there is an effort in Kubernetes multi-cluster seek to bring in a cluster ID for every cluster that will be unique across clusters. Okay, now let us go into one of the cluster, like clusters. Right? If you see the west cluster, there is one node that is marked as the gateway node. You can see the same in the east cluster as well. So in every cluster, there will be one node that will be elected as the gateway node. And this node will connect to the broker cluster. And once it connects to the broker cluster, it will update its local information. Basically, it populates both the CRDs, its local information with the broker cluster. And it will retrieve the information about all the other clusters to the local. Okay, and by this way, it learns about all the clusters that are available or like that are connected together, and it will create an IPsec tunnel to the gateway node of the other clusters. If you can see in the figure, there is a IPsec tunnel that has been created from the gateway node in the east cluster to the gateway node in the west cluster. Okay, so yeah, now let us look at the Submariner components of Submariner. So Submariner has mainly two components. The first is the Submariner engine, and the second is the Submariner route agent, which is a daemon set. So this Submariner engine runs on all gateway nodes. So what does this mean by all gateway nodes? So in our deployment, we mark some of the nodes as gateway capable nodes. Say if you go to the previous year, say we can mark worker 1 or worker 2 as gateway capable. So whichever node is marked as gateway capable, Submariner engine will be running on that. It performs a leader election, and one of the Submariner, if there are multiple nodes that are marked as gateway capable node, one of them will be elected as the leader. And this leader node is responsible for connecting with the broker cluster and sharing its information and retrieving the information of the other clusters. It also interfaces with Charon to create the IPsec tunnels with all the gateway nodes of all the other clusters that are connected. Okay. Now the next component is the Submariner DAO route agent. So this will be running in all the clusters, all the nodes in a cluster. And this is aware about the, who is the current leader. Okay. So in the node, that is the gateway node, it will sit idle, it does not do anything. In all the other nodes that are not the gateway nodes in a cluster, it is responsible for injecting the routing rules so that all the packets that are addressed to a different cluster will be sent to the gateway nodes. And one more thing about Sorbonne engine is like whichever in whichever node that's not a gateway node, the Sorbonne engine will be idle in that nodes. Okay. Now let us see how the gateway node election happens. So if you see in the West cluster, there is four worker nodes, and if you can see from the diagram, like worker 1, 3, and 4 in the West cluster, and worker 2, 3, and 4 in the East cluster are marked as the gateway node label, or like they will participate in the gateway node election. So Sorbonne uses Kubernetes simple leader election, and one of them will be elected as the leader. So if you see in the West cluster, so it was the worker 4 that got elected as the leader, and similarly in the East, it's worker 3 that got elected. Now worker 4, once it's like elected as a leader, it will connect to the broker cluster, and it will, like as I mentioned earlier, it will update the its local information and tries to retrieve the information about the other clusters. So every other gateway node tries this and learns about the all the clusters that are connected. So as you see, as you can see, once the election was election happened and the gateway nodes are elected, their IPsec tunnel will be created. So here you can see from the worker 4 in the West cluster to the worker 3, the who are the leaders in their respective cluster, and IPsec tunnel was created. Okay. Now as you see from the figure, like every other traffic to the other clusters, say the traffic from worker 4, worker 2, or worker 3 to the any other node in the East cluster has to flow through the gateway node. So there is a single point of failure. So we have a high availability framework built in. So this ensures that if gateway nodes in an event like if the gateway nodes goes down, a new gateway node is elected, and the rules are reprogrammed. So if you see in the figure, assume that the worker 4 in the West cluster, which was the earlier leader, went down due to some reason. So now a new leader election happens. So whichever nodes are labeled, remaining nodes which are labeled, participates in the election. So worker 1 and worker 3 here, and one of them will get elected as the leader. So here worker 1 got elected as the leader. So worker 1 now updates the broker that, okay, there is a leader change, and these are my details. So now in the West cluster, there will be subminiary route agent component that I mentioned earlier. That will also be notified about this new leader change. So it will reprograms its routing rules, which were earlier pointing to worker 4, to the worker 1, so that the traffic to the other cluster, it will use worker 1. Similarly, since the broker is updated about the leader change, East cluster also learns about this, okay, there is a leader change. So what it does is, it changes its, or like reprograms its IP text tunnel to point it to the newly elected worker node, that's the worker 1. Okay. Now let us go back to the earlier problem domain that Sridhar explained. So he mentioned about two things broadly, like that you can divide the problem domains into service connectivity and cluster connectivity. So what works today is the cluster connectivity part of this of the problem domain. So first thing he mentioned was like the tunnel management, as we saw in the previous architecture diagram, the tunnels are IPsec tunnels are created, and they are created between the gateway nodes, and through this IPtech tunnel you can reach all the other clusters. And second part is the routing rules. So the once Sorbonne engine learns about other clusters, it will program routing rules in the gateway nodes to reach other clusters. Say for this CIDR you can go to the East cluster, for this CIDR it is available in the North cluster. So these routing rules will be injected by the Sorbonne engine. Now in the all the other nodes that are not gateway nodes, as I mentioned, the Sorbonne route agent will program the rule that could send the packet to the gateway node. From the gateway node, the rules that are programmed by the Suryanarayanan engine will take it to the other cluster. Sridhar will be showing it in a more detailed way. Now, there are some prerequisites for Suryanarayanan that we expect for this Suryanarayanan to work properly. The first thing is like we need to know about the cluster configuration before deploying the Suryanarayanan so that each clusters know how to connect to the broker and how he could retrieve the information about the other clusters. So there should be some knowledge about the cluster configuration. Also, Suryanarayanan expects the port and service CIDR to be known overlapping. What does mean is like each individual cluster, like in our diagram, we had east cluster and west cluster. The service CIDR as well as the port CIDR needs to be currently known overlapping so that Suryanarayanan can work, because Suryanarayanan just like insert role based on the CIDRs. So for this CIDR, you can go to this cluster. So the routing roles are inserted in that pattern. So we expect that this needs to be known overlapping. Okay, now Sridhar will just go through a life of a packet.
Thank you, Ashwin. So let me take a small example of how a packet traverses in this when you have two clusters. Now imagine you have a west cluster and an east cluster. Just for sake of simplicity, we are trying to use like, you know, as minimal number of you know, nodes in this diagram. So as Ashwin mentioned, you have two components of Suryanarayanan running in your clusters. On the worker nodes, you have the Suryanarayanan route agent, and on the gateway node, you have the Suryanarayanan engine component. So let's assume that, you know, you have two pods. Pod A, which is running on worker 1 of your west cluster, and pod B, which is running on worker 2 of your east cluster. Assuming that pod A knows the IP address of pod B, I'll quickly take you through how the packet actually traverses. Whenever pod A is trying to send a traffic to pod B, you would have Suryanarayanan route agent running on worker 1 that would have programmed the necessary routing rules to forward the traffic to the local gateway node. Once it reaches the local gateway node, traffic would be encapsulated into an IPsec tunnel, assuming that these two clusters are in, like, you know, connected through IPsec tunnel. Traffic gets encapsulated in the IPsec tunnel and forwarded to the remote cluster gateway node. After it reaches the remote cluster gateway node, it gets decrypted and it looks at the destination IP. It happens to be the IP address of pod B, and the respective CNI of your cluster would forward the traffic accordingly to the, which in this particular case is the worker 2, which is hosting pod B. Now this is how the communication happens from a pod in one cluster to other cluster. The same thing generally happens when a pod is trying to access a cluster IP service. Now coming to the current state, like we have a healthy future. I mean, like lots of work is pending. Suryanarayanan in its current stage is like we consider this as a pre-alpha. So we don't recommend Suryanarayanan to be used in any production kind of environments. So please bear that in mind. The other one is like it only supports cluster connectivity part today. It doesn't support the service connectivity, which includes multi-cluster service discovery and network policy. However, we are actively working on, you know, getting these features you know, integrated as part of Suryanarayanan. The next one is support for different types of topologies. Today, when you have multiple clusters connected via Suryanarayanan, there is a full mesh of IPsec tunnels that is created between the gateway nodes of all your participating clusters. We are trying to provide a mechanism wherein after you actually associate all the clusters, we want to make it configurable wherein you can say that out of all the n number of clusters that you have, you only want to connect some of them so that you can discover and access only certain cluster IP services out of all the clusters. The next one is support for different types of tunnels. Today, with the cluster connectivity part of Suryanarayanan, you can set up IPsec tunnels between your clusters. So it only supports IPsec-based tunnels. And it generally works in most of the cases because you might be interested in setting up tunnels between an on-prem versus a public cloud kind of environments. However, we are looking at adding a plugin based architecture, which in the Submariner terminology we call it as a cable engine. We want to implement a couple of cable engines that allow us to support different types of tunnels like VXLAN, IP in IP, and so on. The next important thing is monitoring of the solution, which is an important thing. And talking to different stakeholders and people, we came across that they are also looking at supporting overlapping CDRs. So as Ashwin mentioned earlier, one of the prerequisites today for Submariner is that you need to have the pod CIDRs and service CIDRs of your clusters to be non-overlapping. In a brownfield kind of environment, this could actually be a little challenging because you might have deployed your clusters with the default configuration where the pod and service CIDRs overlap. So we have a couple of ideas in our mind, and maybe going forward, we want to, depending on the feasibility, we want to support even this particular use case. And last but not least, like leveraging some of the public cloud services wherever possible. You can find the Submariner Git repo in this particular slide. We meet every Tuesday at 15 hours UTC in Blue Jeans. And both the Rancher as well as Red Hat are working collectively to move the Submariner project, which currently is in Rancher repo, to multi-cluster SIG. So as we speak, there is some active discussion that is going on in the SIG multi-cluster mailing group. You can find the link to the email chain that has some interesting conversation. So anybody interested in Submariner, we would actually be more than happy to welcome you. We have like a bunch of folks working on it, and you know, we are very open to seek your feedback. And if you are interested in working with us, you know, we're happy to help. So come join us, it'll be fun. Yeah, if you have any questions, yeah.
Yeah, hi, I have one question, yeah. Does the local agent update the route to the leader so that the work can communication with the local gateway, right?
Okay, so.
You know, you said that only host node have one agent, yeah?
Right.
Yeah, you know, what's the function of agent? Is that the agent to adapt or send a route to the leader, and so that they can publish the route to all the nodes, and so and the work communication with the local gateway, and yeah, you know, you says that you the private or public cloud use the IPsec tunnel, and the how to the work to communication for example, and what's the cluster work one in how to communication with the gateway node, you use the what technology that use the network protocol, or for example root protocol, or you just add the root by your managing software, yeah, for the most
I think it's the question like how the packet from work and one reach the gateway node. Is that the question? Yeah. Okay. So, as I mentioned, there are two components. One is the Submariner gateway, Submariner engine, and the Submariner route agent. So, this route agent knows who is the current leader. Okay. And for all the traffic that is for the remote cluster, he will insert a rule in the worker one so that if there is a traffic to a different cluster, he'll send that traffic to the gateway node. So there is a routing rule added for that. Is that
so,
clear?
So it's like, you know, from what I understand, your question is there are a couple of agents. There are two main components in the Submariner architecture. One, if you imagine this particular diagram, let's talk about the West cluster. You have worker one and worker two. Now these are the daemon set pods, which Kubernetes ensures that at any point of time you have a pod scheduled on the worker node. What they do is they constantly monitor the local gateway node. So there is another pod running on the gateway node, which we call as a Submariner engine. So these pods will try to be in sync with the local gateway node, and the local gateway node will be in sync with the broker cluster. So your pod seeders, service seeders in this particular diagram, it's like 10.0.0.0 and say 172.11.0.0. Now this information along with the cluster information, which is the cluster identity, will be advertised to the broker, and it also reconciles that information of the other clusters to itself. So the pods, which are submariner route agents running on the worker nodes, only have to know who is the local leader so that I can forward all the traffic associated to my remote cluster to my local gateway node.
Sorry, I have two questions. The first one is about the router. Here, the router is just one normal pod of this cluster or just one independent device?
Yes. Okay. Yes, that's a good question. So today, if you download Submariner, by the way, which you actually can do, so it is something that you can evaluate yourself. Like if you are interested in this hybrid cloud kind of environment, you can just go git clone Submariner and then give it a try. There's an interesting video that is done by Chris Kim from Rancher. So coming back to your question, currently broker is an independent cluster. So what we are doing is
I just suspect about the performance because you created the IPsec tunnels, mm-hmm. and you know IPsec tunnel will cost a lot of resource. Yeah, cost some latency.
Okay, so right. I hope your question is not like here we are using broker mainly as a data store. So what happens is the local gateway nodes update the CRDs on the broker about the information of the cluster. But for the actual data, let's assume that you have a pod on cluster west and is talking to pod on cluster east, that will never go through the broker. It actually goes via IPsec tunnel, as you said, and yes, IPsec has its own latencies and all, but naturally I think that is anyway inevitable when you're connecting an on-prem cluster with a public cloud. So you want to have some kind of encryption into the data, so you don't want to just send plain traffic in a public domain. So that is one thing. So at the same time, we have plans to leverage some of the public cloud service providers' hardware. Like for example, if you take AWS, we have plans to use AWS hardware VPNs wherever possible. At least that can help us, you know, to speed up the traffic and decrease the latency.
Thank you. The second question is about the multiple interfaces within one pod supporting, such as for Kubernetes, we have the multi-tenant CNI or some DEM CNI or some other CNIs. It can support multiple interfaces within one pod.
Okay.
For that case, do you plan to improve it?
So are you saying that does this particular solution support pods with multiple interfaces?
Yeah.
The Maltus project you're talking about?
Yes.
Okay. We haven't evaluated that, but we kind of briefly did some kind of demo with Maltus, but not with Submariner. So this particular solution today works with the CNIs that are based out of IP tables kind of implementation. So we evaluated this on Flannel, Kennel, as well as OpenShift.
Okay.
So these are the three different CNIs with which we evaluated Submariner. So if you have a CNI that is very much aligned with this, it might work out of box for you. But I mean, to be honest, we haven't tested each and every CNI.
Okay.
But our end goal is to have some kind of driver framework which helps us to capture the CNI specific implementation in that particular driver.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Hello. I have one question. In current architect, how do you solve the service discovery problem? Like if you have a pod in west cluster and another pod in east cluster, and it's a service and client model, and you have a service, and the east cluster want to visit the west cluster using kubernetes like service discovery. So how do you fix this problem?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and as we said, we don't have a solution yet for that. We have some use case document wherein we started capturing the kind of use cases that we want to address, and we are trying to get some feedback from the community. So there are some pull requests both for, like, I think, service discovery as well as for network policy. Once we have some kind of idea on agreement on the use cases that we intend to solve, we have few ideas in our mind saying how we will solve it.
Okay,
we don't have a PR for that yet, but yeah.
So this is the service is from using the port IP, right?
I think it's timeout, but we'll be here. Okay. So what we can do is, we can just
thank
discuss. Thank you. Thanks for attending.